Whatever. Hey, let's talk about movies. I don't know what they're talking about.
Oh, so here's Jeremy Jahns.
One thing that can get us back on track, and that is more blue.
Let's go blue.
Also, here is Mark Ellis.
I was back on track this morning until Jeremy Jahns informed me that I might have trouble borrowing one of his football jerseys for a stunt I wanted to do next week. You think I'm going to get my Redskin stink on your precious Seahawks
it's
garb?
It's called a stunt. What are you going to do with my Sherman jersey?
Don't worry about it, okay?
Okay, so listen. As happens sometimes, something came up that we weren't prepared for. So, but let's talk about this quickly before we get to our first official topic of the day. Okay, so... number of days ago, Ben Affleck, in a interview, was asked directly. Actually, I'm going to pull up his exact quote. Was asked if he was going to direct the next Batman film. All right. Now, obviously, he was going to direct the next Batman film, but something was going on because his response at the time was this. This is his exact quote. When asked if he was going to direct Batman, he says, "It's not a set thing." Those are Ben Affleck's words. Those were not right. Our words. Not anybody else's words. These are Ben Affleck's words. It's not a set thing. Then he went on to talk about how the script wasn't where he wants it to be. And, of course, it's his script. He's the one writing the script. So it got a lot of people talking and speculating. We speculated on this show about, okay, look, number one, we only have – this is exactly what we said. We said we only have a finite amount of information here. There's probably a mountain of other information that would change our perspective. But let's speculate based on this much information. My speculation was – that I think this was Ben firing a warning shot at WB. That was my interpretation of the comment. I said, you know, if I had to put money on it, Ben's definitely going to be directing Batman, but I think this is Ben firing a warning shot at WB. I think this is a sign that W's probably interfering with him, and he's just firing a warning shot in the public. Now, fast forward now a couple of days. Last night, Ben Affleck's on Kimmel, right? And in a very awkward last-minute thing that was obviously arranged, Kimmel asked Affleck, are you directing Batman? Same question. Now, whereas he did say a few days ago, it's not a set thing, last night he said was, yes, I'm definitely directing Batman. Which is, for all of us who are Ben Affleck in the DC Cinematic Universe fans, let us all go, ah, a big sigh of relief. But I still believe that is the result. I don't believe for a second that there was no fire. When Affleck was making those public comments, where there is smoke, I believe in that situation there was fire. I believe this is a result of Warner Brothers going, we got the message. And again, let's be clear here. I have no insider information on this. This is pure speculation on my part. Take that as what this is. This is opinion, okay? I'm not telling you this is the fact. This is my opinion. But when I look at that situation, where on day one day he's saying, it's not a set thing that I'm directing. And then the next day he's like, I'm definitely directing. In a very short statement tagged on at the end of an interview on Kimmel, to me that was, there was a situation behind the scenes. That situation got resolved. One way or the other, that situation got resolved. And once again, for those of us who are fans of Affleck in the DC Cinematic Universe, but I don't believe for a second, that was never a problem. No. There was a problem. There was clearly a problem. A guy as seasoned and as experienced and who knows the Hollywood landscape and the media landscape as much as Ben Affleck, a guy who knew exactly what the reaction of the world was going to be when he got announced as Batman, when everybody shit on the idea and everybody mocked DC.
Except for a few people.
Except for a couple of us who jumped online immediately and said, mark our words, this is brilliant. I do believe there was a problem. But even if there was, first of all, if there wasn't a problem, awesome. If there was a problem, awesome, because clearly that problem's been resolved. But I know, Schnepp, you saw this whole thing unfold last night.
Right.
What was your interpretation of it?
Well, I think problem has been solved. Whatever that smoke was, wherever that fire was, has been put out. There's like a giant ice truck. There's like some firemen. They're all wearing Affleck shirts. I mean, I think, yeah. I mean, whatever he was trying to accomplish by creating that giant buzz by saying, I'm not sure about the script, even though I'm writing it, and, you know, I might not do it if it's not up to snuff. That got resolved, whatever those issues are, which I'm happy to hear, that he's saying the script is getting better and better. I'm going to, you know, no one was giving me this kind of flack with Live by Night, but that's a film that went under the radar. And he looks just like Dick Tracy in that poster.
He really does.
He really does.
He really does look like he's got a little yellow tint going on. Anyway, I'm very happy, and I'm glad he didn't say, "Well, I will be directing the Batman, but I'm not going to play the Batman." That would have just been crazy.
Wouldn't it be great if he just trolled everybody?
Right?
That would be awesome. Yeah. What do you think, Jeremy?
I would love that. Like, I'm directing. Am I going to star in it? Just let everyone think about it.
Warner Brothers people and my people are talking. Right.
My people are talking about their people.
Out, like, hey, guys, back.
Yeah, I think it happens just like that. Sometimes an actor or a producer or a director or someone has to take a shot past the bow. The studio will get it, and then they'll it'll all get resolved somehow. Didn't he say something like, yes, I'll do it. Just give it time. Gosh, or am I making that up? Wasn't it?
I think that was a general consensus statements,
too. He's like, guys, chill out. I always feel bad for an actor or someone who's like, all right, you have this new movie, Live by Night. So Batman, and you know he's getting all that on Twitter, and these are just human beings, you know, like we see them as otherworldly people who make the entertainment that we love, but in the end they're people and they have like stresses and projects they do. So I'm sure he's like, God, yeah, this is it's gonna happen, shut up, you know. So I feel my heart goes out to Mr. Affleck, but I'm glad he's back in the seat of the Batman.
It's funny because last night on Kimmel, I think this was the exact quote, and you're right. I feel bad for him. He's been working on Live by Night for so long, and like, look, if you look at any of his other pictures, Affleck puts so much heart and so much passion into his films that he directs. It's crazy. And he's on Kimmel. You can tell he's a bit frustrated because, like, I'm working on Live by Night for whatever, but nobody gives a shit about Live by Night. They're just asking me about this. And he actually swore on network television last night because no one gives a shit about Live by Night. They just want to know about Batman.
Yep, Batman.
And so I feel bad for the dude at the same time. Anyway, what did you think about this whole stuff?
I was happy that my good friend Ben Affleck backed me up because I sat here in this panel and I watched grown men weep and cower and run for the hills because they were sure Ben Affleck and Batman was so much in trouble. He's just frustrated, guys. Mm-hmm. He's just frustrated because of what Jeremy brought up. Every time he's promoting his movie, Live by Night, somebody sticks a mic in his face and they ask him about Batman, and the scary thing about this is that he already has not even been in a standalone Batman movie, and he already has the same take on it Michael Keaton had after Batman Returns. Like, he's already disgruntled, he's already tired of the thing, and the movie's not coming out for another 3 years. It's gonna happen. Don't worry about it. He's just a little sick of answering questions about it, which is fair.
There are reports coming out, too, that, because remember, they just bumped one movie to put Batman in its slot. There are reports coming out that is being bumped, that Batman is going to be bumped off that date. Those are the reports that are circulating right now. And if it is, no big deal. It's not like the movie was supposed to come out 7 months from now, and then they bump it. That's a lot of red flags. The movie was still years away. They've reassessed the situation when it's going to be prepared. They're going to move it a little bit, and that's all fine, and that's all cool. But either way, it looks like everything is good again, and we can all look forward. Because, look, I believe this. I believe this from the day they announced Ben Affleck as being the new Batman 3 years ago, that Schnepp, you and I did that quick Skype video for everybody and talked about it. I believed it then, and I believe it now. I honestly believe that Ben Affleck is the best chance that the DC Cinematic Universe has of reaching that pinnacle that it has the potential to have. Because when you got characters like Batman, Superman, Wonder Woman, you're talking about the Holy Trinity of all comic book characters, not just DC, like you're talking about the Holy Trinity of comic book characters anywhere. When you got that much potential, and then you got, and you've had a little bit, I think even the most diehard of DC cinematic fans will agree that it's off to a bit of a rocky start, a little bit. Hasn't had the audience-wide support they'd hoped it would. It hasn't had the critical support they hoped it would. That, fine, whatever. That's behind us. That's all behind us now. I believe, I always have, and I still do, that Ben Affleck is the best chance for DC to reach its full potential. And so, yeah, look, guys like me, I was hitting the panic button because I don't want to hear about any discord between Warner Brothers and Affleck. I want to hear about tea parties and cupcakes and mutual massages. I want to hear about everybody loving each other over their movie work, because I really do believe Ben Affleck with DC is a magic formula that can yield some really good stuff. So, please, guys, keep that relationship really good, because I don't know how much more of this I can take.
I'm happy to see you brought the Chewbacca mug and not the orange panic button here.
All right, what's our first official story of the day?
While Rogue One is still doing well at the box office, all eyes are now on the next chapter in the Star Wars Saga, Episode 8. We still don't have any concrete details or even a title, but thanks to USA Today, we do have some new details about the relationship we'll see between Luke and Rey. Speaking with the outlet set for their big 2017 preview, writer-director Rian Johnson confirmed the movie would indeed pick up right where The Force Awakens left off, while also offering up some new specifics about their relationship we'll see in the movie. "I don't want to skip ahead 2 years," Johnson said. "I want to see the very next moment of what happens. How Rey and Luke relate to each other is the key relationship in Episode 8, and Johnson says a large part of the movie will be spent addressing why Luke's there and what he'll do next. John, what do you think about the comments made by Rian Johnson about Episode 8?
What can I say? I get giddy and excited about this type of stuff. Yeah, I'm to hear that much of the movie is going to focus on that relationship between them. I wouldn't be surprised. I'm not predicting this. I wouldn't be surprised if they do a little bit of a Rogue One with Episode 8, which is something that a Star Wars episodic movie's never done, where the movie picks up where the last one left off, right there on that island, her holding out. It's like, are you going to take it or not? And then maybe it fast forwards 3 years. Mm. I mean, they might do something like that. They've never done that in an episodic movie before, so we'll see. But I want to see... I'm excited for this for two reasons. Number one, I want to see that relationship between the two. I want to see a Padawan and a Master again. I want to see that unfolding of that relationship. But number two, if that is going to be a focus of the movie, we're going to get a lot of Luke. And, you know, I wanted more Luke in Episode 7. I was very happy with the way Episode 7 worked out, but I wanted a lot more Luke. I'm just, you know, if Luke pulls out a lightsaber... and starts going at some fools. I'm like, that's it. I'm done. I'm like, everything's great in the world again. I'm still 100% convinced that Luke and Rey are not father and daughter.
100%.
100% now. Yep, 100%. Wow. And I'm very happy that we've won over Christian Harloff. As well, Harloff used to be a diehard. No, Luke is Rey's father. Nah, he doesn't think so anymore. I'm 100% convinced of that at this point. But
I love how you're like, we've won him over.
Like a bomb.
Good.
We got him over. But I mean, look, whatever it is, even if he does end up being her father, that relationship, getting Luke full fledged back into the Star Wars universe again, I'm super excited about it. What do you think about all this?
You know, I had the same thought you did, where they could skip ahead in time. They've proven that we're now allowed to do that in Star Wars movies. I don't know that it would work. Like I'm still trying to wrap my head around, as much as I want to see the next moment, the first thing that Luke actually will say to Rey when he sees she's handing the lightsaber and who she is and what their relationship is. But you start out with the Episode 8. Hey, we're all excited to see Episode 8. Here's the three paragraphs recovering what we just saw in Force Awakens, because it's hard to give us any more backstory if the movie's picking up exactly where we left off. All the other crawl text has given us some context as to what happened between the last movie and this new movie we're about to witness. If there's no space to do that, is the crawl text just like, hey guys, thanks for coming back. We appreciate your business last year, and we're excited to make another movie. Here's Luke and Rey. Like, I don't know how it does it. And then, you know, you have the pan down where it's always panning down into outer space. It's never panned down into outer space and then done like a Scorsese zoom just right into an actual planet. So how are they going to pull that off? I'm very excited. I'm a little, not nervous is the wrong word, but I just want it to feel like an episodic Star Wars movie, but I do need to see what their initial conversation was. So it's exciting to hear that Luke and Rey are going to be the focus of Episode 8. That's what we suspected. It's going to be her learning about the Force, maybe learning about her past, and also seeing what Luke's past of the last 30 years has been involved in. That's the most exciting stuff for me. He's my favorite Star Wars character, so I want to see him be the bulk of Episode 8.
You know, I think they could do with that opening, with the opening crawl, I think a lot of the opening crawl will focus on the First Order. Yeah. And I think you could have that space shot. It comes down, and then you get the shot of General Gingerhair and with a very wrecked Kylo Ren. Yeah, Gingerhair, that's what I said. And Kylo Ren now on their ship heading to wherever it was that Snoke said, get Kylo and bring him here. And I think that's probably where that will start off, but then we'll quickly go back.
You could fudge the timeline a little bit.
And then they can shoot right back to the island and go back to where they are, but... who knows? What do you think?
I agree. I was like, the buffer, the space gap will be when it's like,
Snoke has ordered that Kylo Ren be brought to him. That'll be the opening crawl. Then you have, yeah, he's got his scar on his face, you know, and then Snoke's like, it's time for your training. And then then it goes back to Luke and Rey. And the last moment they saw each other. You could have Luke and Rey see each other and then go bam to Star Wars and then do the crawl. I mean, just throwing out new things here, but I don't think they're going to do that necessarily. I love the fact that Luke and Rey are going to be the focal point. Their relationship's going to be the focal point, because no matter what, I firmly believe Luke knew about Rey, or at least the concept of Rey. He knew that a person would find him on that island, and that is the person he is to train. And so that's an important relationship to embrace. I want to know how he might have known that. If there's one flaw I have in The Empire Strikes Back, is that I wanted to see more Yoda and Luke. Like, I just wanted to see more of that. So the fact that this movie will give me more of that element, I think that's great. The only reason, because I'm a big Hot Toys collector, the only reason I have not gotten my old Luke from Force Awakens, because I think in the next one they'll have one. They'll have a Luke for Episode 8. I think that Luke will have a lightsaber that ignites. And that's what I'm holding out for. I'm just crossing my fingers for that. So we'll see what happens.
Ooh, another Hot Toys sweaty, just like Burnett.
Oh, yeah. Right here.
You know what?
You know, we should consider a Hot Toys unboxing show with Robert Meyer Burnett and Jeremy Jahns.
That's right.
I love Hot Toys.
I think I'd watch it. You know what? It's funny you said that, because that was my theory. I think it's going to start out with a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away. We're going to cut to the planet with her holding out that lightsaber. They're going to have a little conversation. Luke's going to be like, I am your father. Or something along those lines, whatever. Kenobi's your granddaughter, via Snoke's weird force, midichlorians, however they figure it out. They're going to talk for a minute. Then it would be so cool to just like have Luke say something badass, or like, your training begins now, and then Star Wars comes in. Then you have it cuts
so
away.
So you're thinking they do like what a lot of television shows do today, which is a television show starts, no opening credits. Television starts in the story, goes for about 2 minutes, and then opening credits. You're thinking maybe Star Wars could
do
something like that?
They'll tag, I'll think they tag a long time ago in a galaxy far away. We go
and
to that
cut
planet.
Right to the planet. Yeah.
Then we get like 3 minutes.
I love your creativity. The original Beatles
that was the most
have a better
dismissive
chance
tone I've ever
together.
Heard come out of
hey,
you.
It literally never happened.
Ellis can be wrong. I'm not mad at
him. I was wrong once in 2007, and I acknowledge that.
I like that, because then you could jump forward like a year.
You could. You totally could.
I always had this. All right, so if we're springboarding off that, imagine this. A long time ago in Galaxy Far, Far Away, it goes to Rey walking up to Luke, and if you listen to the soundtrack, that song, and then it climbs to where it goes to end credits.
It almost sounds like Game of Thrones for a second.
It kind of does. It kind of does sound like Game of Thrones. But then when it climbs, instead of going to end credits, go to the band, and then like it's Star Wars. You know, I don't know. That's a really cool thought that they might be able to do. And since they threw new things at the wall to see what sticks with a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away in Rogue One and then cutting to a planet, it obviously works. It didn't offset a lot of people, so they can do it now, and they know that.
As long as they get the same guy who's an expert at iMovie to do the credits that did it for Rogue One, then I'm cool with that.
Your version of "I like your creativity" was the verbal incarnation of a pat on the head.
It's a beautiful drawing. It's going to go right on the fridge. You made the fridge.
Don't hate me if I'm right, Ellis.
All right, what's
or
next?
Me and Jeremy, both of us.
I would love to see a standing bet right now.
I'll do. I'll put $100 bucks on it. I'll put $100 bucks.
$100. You guys saw.
Is this binding? If they don't physically touch, is it binding?
This is video binding.
Hold his hand. Hold his hand. We're all like my proxy.
Okay,
we're
there.
My proxy.
There
we
go. It's happening.
It happened. $100. Transfer through.
All right, now what's next?
Digital media company Onion Inc., responsible for both The Onion and Clickhole, yesterday announced a partnership with production company Serious Business to create 3 films over 2 years for Lionsgate. The in-house film and TV development arm at The Onion will team with the executive producers on Comedy Central's late night show At Midnight with Chris Hardwick to develop the 3 films for Lionsgate to distribute, pulling from existing Onion IP along with some original ideas mined from the creative community. Speaking about the partnership, Kyle Ryan, vice president of Onion Studios, said, "We've plotted our takeover of the film industry for some time. With the help of Serious Business and Lionsgate, we'll make room on our award shelf for some Oscars. To the basement you go, Pulitzers." Mark, are you excited for a movie made by the creators of The Onion?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I love the Onion. You and I were gushing about our favorite all-time Onion headlines of the pre-production meeting. I personally had all the collections, the books you can get of all the different headlines, like their classic hits. And Dispatches from the Tenth Circle was my favorite. I highly recommend hitting a Barnes & Noble and picking it up. That's one of my favorite headlines in Onion history is Tenth Circle added to rapidly growing hell. They're just the way that they skewer politics, the way they'll skewer sports, anything that happens in our society, the Onion is who you go to for brilliant satire. So them having a deal with the production team and at midnight, that's a lot of credibility there too. So I'm not looking for Oscar-related material. You can be concerned that it's going to turn into like what the National Lampoon was doing, where it's like, oh, we're just going to crank out Van Wilder 4 and, you know, crappy Spring Break movies. I think the Onion is going to be smarter than that, and I have a lot of faith in what this deal could be.
Look, writing for a magazine, whether it's digital or not, is a far cry from motion pictures, absolutely. But The Onion has smart, funny people involved. And by the way, I hope maybe, hey Dennis, maybe we can find this and put a link to it in the description below. If you have not seen the Onion video that they did on their announcement that Marvel announces developing an Iron Man movie based on their smash hit Iron Man trailer. If you have not seen that video, it is one of the funniest things they have ever done. I've been a huge fan of The Onion. My personal favorite collection is Our Dumb Century. So look up The Circle, look up Dumb Century. Those you'll love every single page in those books will have you smiling and laughing and giggling. I think it's a really interesting move for a medium like this to try to step out. The important part, the part that makes me think this can work, is this. If Onion had just announced, we're creating our own film division and we're just going to go at it and do this, I might be a little bit worried. The fact that they are smart enough to go, look, we think we got a lot of talent. We're going to partner with Lionsgate, who are movie people and motion picture people, and together we're going to try making three films. That gives me a lot of hope. I'm excited about it, actually more excited than I probably should be. So yeah, I'm big on this. What do you think?
I love to laugh. I love satire. I'm one of those people, like, I still watch South Park and enjoy it because the things that they poke at are relevant social parameters that we today, you know, we live in, you know, and I feel like The Onion embraces that. The quote alone right there at the beginning of this segment makes it like anyone who was kind of like hesitant about it, that quote alone is like, yeah, I'll give you a shot because that's the most brilliant thing to say I can't say anything you guys haven't already said. From what I've seen and found, people spoof and have satire on things that we feel are important. There are things that happen in the news, in the world, that make people bite their nails, make them cry, make them pull their hair out. And people like The Onion come along and they're like, hey, here's that. You can still have fun with it. I think that's an important thing to do. And I love the fact that we're all embracing that. So yeah, give them the three-picture deal. I can't wait.
Schnepp.
I'm really excited about this. The Onion is fantastic. And I look at it like you said, National Lampoon, but like maybe Animal House National Lampoon when it was actually relevant.
Right,
or even
right.
Like going back to like the Zucker Brothers, Airplane, Top Secret. It's like those kinds of comedies are not made anymore. Mm-hmm. And I think The Onion and their crack writing staff can take that level of comedy that's now and bring some of that. So I cannot wait. I love The Onion. So this is great news.
You know what's funny is in my top 10 worst movies of the year video for this last year, there was a couple of those horrible spoofs were on there. And I was there was a time people made great spoofs. That time is gone now.
Right.
And now we're here. So it'd be great if they brought it back.
I don't know that you can get the spoof movie back to where it was, but I root for
That's
it.
That's why
I love
we're here, though. You know you want it. You want it.
Like, if you're looking at movies like Hot Shots Part 2, obviously the king of them all, Airplane. Mm-hmm. My personal favorite, Top Secret.
Top Secret is the funniest in my opinion too, but you got Naked Gun, you have Kentucky Fried Movie. There's
well,
a
Top
lot
Secret
of great
Secret was
spoof
the
movies.
First Naked Gun. When you look at it, I just watched it again. I was like, wow, that's actually the origin of the Naked Gun style of humor.
Latrine! All right, guys, it is Tuesday, which means it's time for us to talk about what is opening this week, brought to you by our friends at AMC Theaters. There's actually five films going wide this week. We're going to talk about two of them today. Ashley, which ones are those?
First up is Live by Night. Set in the 1920s and 1930s, the story follows Joe Coughlin, the son of a Boston police captain. After moving to Ybor City, Tampa, Florida, he becomes a bootlegger and a rum runner and later a notorious gangster. Also coming out is Patriot's Day. Tragedy strikes on April 15, 2013, when two bombs explode during the Boston Marathon. In the aftermath of the attack, Police Sergeant Tommy Saunders, Mark Wahlberg, FBI Special Agent Richard Delorier, Kevin Bacon, and Commissioner Ed Davis, John Goodman, join courageous survivors, first responders, and other investigators in a race against the clock to hunt down the suspects and bring them to justice.
If you have not seen Patriot's Day yet, and you haven't seen our own Perry Nemiroff, she actually did a non-spoiler review of it a little while ago. Because remember, this film was released, both of these films were released limited in late 2016. Mm-hmm. They're going wide now, so everybody can have a chance to see them. Perry put up a great review. Check that out if you want to go see that, because that's up and available to be seen right now. Look, Ben Affleck's directing it, so I'm excited to see it. I haven't seen it yet and went to go to the premiere last night. I did not. So I still have not seen that. I have seen Patriot's Day. It's effing wonderful. It's wonderful. And this director-actor tandem, Wahlberg and Berg, they are, like, earlier this year, in 2016, they put out Deepwater Horizon, which was, I didn't think that movie was going to be all that good. And Deepwater Horizon was great. And now this comes out, which I think is even better. These guys are on a roll. I think that's three films they've done together now. Mm-hmm. And they're all, like, really good. And they only seem to be gaining momentum. I'm really excited about this weekend. Schnepp, which one of these films are you looking forward to seeing?
I'm glad that you liked Patriots Day. I'm definitely going to see it. But I'm looking forward to Live by Night because I love the Prohibition era films. I love, like, Miller's Crossing, all the film noirs. And that's what this feels like. And just from the trailer alone, I was like, I cannot wait to see this film. So that's the one I'm most amped to see.
Schnepp. You just answered that, Schnepp. Well done.
It's all sweaty this side of the table. I can see how you can get confused. I want to see Live by Night because I want to support Ben Affleck and let him know that I'm not just thinking about the Batman. And thus far, he's done right by as a director. But I've also seen Patriot's Day. It was on my top 10 best of 2016. It's a great movie. It's an impactful movie. It's a powerful movie. But it also does show how people come together in times of crisis, which is a positive on humanity. And sometimes we need to see that. I love that movie.
How excited are you about Patriot's Day going wide, and how excited are you about this other little in-between film for Ben Affleck before Batman?
The Patriots Day movie is what I would focus on because it is so good. It's one of the best movies of 2016. It made my honorable mention, didn't quite get on top 10, but that's no discredit to the movie because what Peter Berg has been able to do is create a Zero Dark 30 vibe that takes place around the tragic events of the 2013 Boston Marathon bombings, and he tells it from all angles. So you get to see the investigative angle, you get to see the first responder angle, the actual runners, the terrorist angle, and it does a great job of humanizing all of the elements without pandering to us too much. Mm. Mark Wahlberg is obviously great. It's got an awesome cast. Jimmy O Yang is somebody else to look out for in that movie. He does a great feature performance in there. And as far as Live by Night goes, it's interesting to see what Batman does when he's in the 1920s Prohibition era. We've never seen Batman deal with a life like this, and it looks like he's going a little evil in this film.
Right. I think he's taking on the persona of Dick Tracy in this film.
He stole my tux from Force Awakens last year, and he's wearing that white. I didn't know that you were allowed to wear a baggy tux back in the day. I thought everything was nice and tight and buttoned up. It's a very loose-fitting tux.
All right, guys, we reached that show now for buy or sell. Here's how this works. In front of her, Ashley's got a few other items in the world of movie news. She's going to run them down. Then those of us at the table are simply going to say whether we buy it or sell it. So, Ashley, what's up?
A new Not Safe for Work trailer was released for Paramount Pictures' Baywatch yesterday, featuring all new footage and some carefully placed F-bombs, reminding fans that this is indeed an R-rated comedy. Seth Gordon's adaptation goes for a comedic skewering of the 90s TV series about sexy lifeguards and features Dwayne Johnson as Mitch Buchanan and Zac Efron co-starring as Matt Brody. The movie opens in theaters on May 26th this summer. Schnepp, buy or sell the new trailer for Baywatch.
I'm going to buy it. I mean, it made me laugh. I mean, anyone who's going to go see Baywatch is not expecting, like, some kind of Oscar winning, like, it made me cry. And
Daniel Day-Lewis as
Captain Scuba Skimp or whatever, you know. Yeah, as the cobbler. Yeah, Baywatch, it made me laugh, especially that those taglines with the cop. I think he's like a sports star. You guys know who that guy is, right?
I do not, actually.
No, he's an actor. Yeah.
The lieutenant?
Yeah.
The captain?
Think so. Yeah.
Okay. Whatever. Anyway, watch that trailer.
What do you think?
Yeah, I'm buying it. And I'm actually going to throw out the fact that it might very well be Daniel Day-Lewis being The Rock. He is that good. We wouldn't know. We would never know the difference. But the trailer made me laugh. That's the point of this trailer. I'm watching this trailer. I'm like, okay, if it doesn't make me chuckle, I'm going to sell it. I buy it because it made me laugh. It's ridiculous. I'm hoping for that 21 Jump Street thing where you go into this movie like, and you walk out like, that was a solid comedy. Probably one of the better comedies of the year. So buying it for sure.
Schnepp.
Can I buy the trailer and not want to see the movie that much?
Like, yeah, we're just talking about the trailer.
Fine, it made me laugh. It was whatever. I just don't care about seeing this movie. Like I see it and I get it. It's a funny spoof on Baywatch, and it's going to have a very Brady Bunch movie, Adam's Family movie, 21 Jump Street kind of vibe. But I just don't care about seeing the movie yet. Like, it made me giggle for 2 minutes. I don't know that I want to be in a theater for 90 minutes watching these jokes happen. It hasn't really showed me anything that I need to actually go see the full movie where I can just giggle and then move on with the rest of my day.
Right. Here's the thing. I'm actually going to buy it. And the reason I'm going to buy it is this. Is when we first found out that they were doing a Baywatch movie and it was going to be a spoof comedy, we all thought, well, this is going to be dumb. Then when we heard, okay, we're adding on people like Hercules. We're adding in The Rock. We're adding in Zac Efron. We're adding in Naked Girl from True Detective. We're adding in all these people. We think, okay, it probably still will be dumb, but with that type of a cast, it could do this, and this right, and that may salvage it. The reason I buy the trailer is because the trailer showed me those things that we thought maybe could be done right with that type of a collection and that type of an approach to the movie seem to be there. The lines that definitely worked. That one, like, if you guys were real cops, you would have been arrested. So it's a good thing we're not cops. Like, there's some good funny lines in there. And I think that's what the best we can hope for from this movie. It's clearly going to be kind of dumb, but maybe it'll give us those laughs that we walk out entertained. And these trailers seem to give me at least a little bit of hope the mail that'll happen, so I give it a buy. All right, what's next?
Disney has given us another look at Beauty and the Beast with a brand new TV spot entitled Belle that aired during the Golden Globes. The short musical spot features Emma Watson's Belle singing a short snippet of the song in her cut with all new footage from the movie. Along with the TV spot comes a new poster from Disney as well, featuring the full cast in their human forms before the inevitable curse transforms them into talking household items. Beauty and the Beast is set for release on March 17th. Jeremy, buy or sell the new TV spot for Beauty and the Beast.
I'm buying the TV spot for Beauty and the Beast. It didn't show me anything I didn't expect to see. It's more embracing the fact that it's like, all right, here's some music from the old Disney animation. Here's some scenery from the old Disney animation. Did you like it before? You'll like it again. It's really trying its best to live up to Mark's expectations of $200 million on opening weekend. But yeah, I buy it for sure. It looks like Disney is still going, yeah, we know what works. Here you go. Here's Beauty and the Beast.
I'm going to buy like everything I've seen from this movie so far. And this trailer just emphasizes even more. I'm loving everything I'm seeing. It looks like they're hitting all the right notes. The one part of this I don't buy is the poster. I'm not huge on the poster. I don't like these posters where you have to cram every single person in this movie into the poster. It's a little bit too busy. The one good thing about the poster is this. I really do think, look, at the Emma Watson casting, great. Obviously, Ian McKellen, great. Ewan McGregor, great. All the people, it's a great cast. But I really think the casting that's going to jump out and really get us the most that we're going to be talking about after the movie is out is Luke Evans as Gaston and Josh Gad as Gafu, LeFou. I think these two, and then I see the picture of them in there. Luke Evans was born to play Gaston. I'm just convinced of it. I cannot wait to see those two guys. So overall, I buy.
I buy the trailer, and I totally sell your take on posters, my good man. I love this poster. I am so excited about this poster. That is what I want to see from a live-action Beauty and the Beast poster. They're selling the movie, Campea. Yes, you're going to want to put the people in the film on the poster. This isn't art class.
All
we're just
them?
Drawing a fruit vase. Yes, we want to show everybody famous that's in the movie. Look, it's Beauty and the Beast. There's a lot of moving parts to that story. We're going to put them on the poster. Let's get excited about it. You know you want to do it, America, and indeed the world. Go see Beauty and the Beast opening weekend.
Even the feather duster maid that the candlestick has sex with, you got to put her on the poster
especially
too?
Especially the feather duster maid.
All right, can we pull up an image of every Star Wars poster ever?
Hey, so I am curious. Like Wendy, I know we can't see you right now because go over to Ashley for a second there because
come and join me.
I'm actually very curious about, first of all, both of you guys' idea about this. What do you guys think about the trailer and about
the poster?
Wendy,
you're starting to shift a little bit, and I think I'm starting to give into the peer pressure or something because I'm kind of starting to like it. The song sounded exactly like the song in the cartoon, and that's what I've kind of been missing, the animated that I grew up with. So it was nice to kind of see that that sounded very similar, I guess.
For me, the TV spot was, no pun intended, spot on. I thought Emma's singing sounded...
That pun was intended. Don't lie.
All right, fine. It was intended.
That was a pun.
Everybody wants to compare Emma Watson's singing voice to Paige O'Hara's singing voice. You can't do that. Paige O'Hara was a Broadway star.
Yeah.
Emma Watson is not, but she can sing, and I have a really high expectation coming out of her as Belle. I love the TV spot, but the poster, I thought it was a little busy. I would have preferred to just see a big poster of just Belle and the Beast with the rose in the middle, like on the bottom, and just ixnay all the other characters for now. And then maybe, take note Disney, maybe you can do separate character posters of like Gaston and LeFou together and Mrs. Potts and Chip together, just saying.
Wendy, let me chime in there on this poster thing. You know, I agree with both of you guys, but what's missing? It's a Photoshop job. Like, look at all these, like, what are those? Beauty and the Beast, are they like 600 feet tall and then everybody gets smaller and smaller as they move forward in scale?
Yes, they're the stars of the movie. That's why they're the biggest
the Photoshop
on the
world has destroyed the art of the movie poster. I go Struzan, I say peak, go back and get some people who can actually paint posters. And if they painted it and gave it that kind of love and that look, like you're talking about those Star Wars posters, those always look cool because they have that magic, that light coming out. This is just a bunch of Photoshop stuff. So I sell the poster, but I love the trailer. I love the TV spot even more than the movie trailer. I think that TV spot made me really want to see the film. So good job on the spot.
Okay, look, so since all of us seem to be really liking what you're seeing, let me throw this out for the people at the table. Over or under 12%, over or under 12%, the chances that Beauty and the Beast actually meets Mark Ellis's ridiculous guess at $200 million opening weekend. I'm saying, remember, the number's 12%. Yeah. Schnepp, over or under that it breaks $200 million opening weekend?
Is Ellis going to let me get that $100 back on this? All right. There's no way in hell it's going to make $200 million. I think it's going to make $199 million.
So you're taking the under 12%.
Taking under 12, 199.
Jeremy.
I mean, I think it's over 12%. I mean, you could say 13%. It's got a 13% chance of it breaking $200 million. Yeah, I'm with Schnepp. It's like I want to Price is Right the entire thing. Like $199.999, please. I think it's over 12%, but it's still that's a large bite.
I will go as high as 20. I'll go as high as, I'm going to take the over on 12%. I think it has a 1 in 5 chance, which is still ridiculously low, but I will take the over on 12. Mark, what do you think? You're going to take your own prediction?
Yeah, I mean, realistically, my percentage number is right there at 100%. We're going to have an after party at Chili's in Encino when we do crown Beauty and the Beast winning over $200 million domestic opening weekend. There's just no way. It just doesn't miss. And the latest TV spot and the poster are just another example. They're one of the many exhibits in the court case of why Beauty and the Beast is making over $200 million.
All right, well, you take it to the bank, folks. Mark Ellis has set it straight. All right, guys, hey, listen, I just want to remind you that we're doing this show live, and when we do it live, at the end of the show, we'd like to save a little bit of time to take your live Twitter questions. So you can start jumping in there now and start firing your questions in. Just make sure you're following us on Twitter, at Collider Video. Send in your questions. Wendy will pick out a couple to read off at the end of the show. I also remind you that a little bit later today, around 5 or 6 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, the newest episode of Heroes goes online with our very own Jon Schnepp and his panel today. And of course, stay tuned to Collider Video all day for breaking news stories that come out. All right. With that out of the way, it's time to get to mailbag. Listen, if you've got a topic or a question you'd like us to address in the show, just email your questions to us at collidervideo@gmail.com. Ashley, what's in the mailbag today?
Callum writes, "Hi, Collider crew. I was looking at the shortlist for Razzie nominations and noticed how many nominations Batman vs. Superman was being considered for and was completely surprised to see Ben Affleck in the worst actor category. I've seen some very puzzling nominations in the past, and I wanted to ask if you think this is simply a guilty by association nomination. Thanks, and keep bringing on the filthy."
That's a great email. Okay, first of all, I love the Razzies. I think the Razzies are so much fun. You can't take them seriously.
See that picture?
See that picture? That's great. I love the Razzies. I think they're so much fun. They're not to be taken seriously, but they're a lot of fun. Look, no, Batman versus Superman should not be nominated for any Razzies. They should not be nominated for any. With maybe, if they had a category for worst editing, maybe.
Right.
Maybe. Batman versus Superman should not be nominated for Razzie. And Ben Affleck, who was the best part of Batman v Superman, should absolutely not be nominated. He here's the funny thing. Even amongst the people out there who hate Batman versus Superman, like just hate it, think it's the most garbage movie ever made. And when you ask him, what did you think about Affleck as Batman? All right, he was all right. I mean, even the most hatred-filled people of Batman vs. Superman will acknowledge that he almost made that movie watchable for them. I like the movie. No way it should be nominated for a Razzie. I get it, though. It's the movie that everybody talks about because it was the most divisive movie of the year. So I get why they're nominating it, but don't take it seriously. Jeremy, what do you think about this?
Yeah, I think that's it's the case of, oh, the movie was disappointing in that it must suck hard. And there's a difference between a movie being disappointing and a movie sucking enough to get a Razzie Award. No, it doesn't deserve it. Like, if I had to pick one, it's like, all right, Jesse Eisenberg's Lex Luthor. I get it. But I mean, yeah, Ben Affleck, wasn't Henry Cavill on there also? He just wasn't in the movie. That's not his fault, you know? That's just the way the movie was laid out, but that is a flaw in the movie, but not his fault. So it is a weird cultural thing where it's just like, oh, the movie's not as good as I wanted it to be. All right, then it must suck. And I just don't think people should think like that. So that's what the Razzies should be called, is the not as good as you wanted them to be awards.
Step.
Well, I mean, when you have the Razzies, films like Independence Day Resurgence come to mind. Those bubble up where you're like, that's a giant steaming pile. So that deserves Razzies, just like Catwoman, just like certain films that the Razzies have nominated. I think Batman v Superman doesn't deserve all of those awards. If they were going to even nominate one award for it, it would be like worst plot device, Martha. That's one I would like 100% back
probably
up.
Probably vote for that.
I would vote for that, and it would win. I think everybody would, you know, kind of agree. But, you know, I don't think it's not even in the same ballpark as some of these other horrible crap films that came out.
What do you think, Mark?
If I took the Razzies seriously, I would say it's stupid and it's atrocious, but I don't. It's a fun sideshow for award season. I think it definitely has a place in society and in Hollywood, because we celebrate all these movies, give them all these fancy awards. It's fun to tear Hollywood down a little bit too, but I would fault Ben Affleck nothing for what he did in Batman v Superman. I actually thought he was really good. Same with Henry Cavill. Some of the supporting actor ones were curious as well, because they nominated Jared Leto for Suicide Squad, which I can see people going either way on that Joker take. I was fine with it, but they also, like, Will Smith was nominated for Worst Actor in Collateral Beauty. It's like, if you didn't like the movie, or they like to pile on sometimes with something that didn't go the way that people wanted it to, and that's what this is.
It also is fascinating that the whole, like, is Ben Affleck going to be Batman again thing? That's a big thing. People want to know. It's like, if they really thought Affleck sucked, they wouldn't care. They'd be like, yeah, get him out of there. The fact that they care shows that he does not deserve that Razzie. At least that.
It gets people talking.
Yeah.
You know?
All right, what's next?
Colton writes, hey, crew at Collider, a longtime fan of the show here. My question is this. What do you think is the probability of Thanos showing up in Thor Ragnarok? Out of the MCU films from now until Infinity War, Ragnarok seems the most likely for a Thanos appearance, considering that the reason Thor left Earth in Age of Ultron was to find out who was behind the sudden appearance of all the Infinity Stones. I feel like a Thanos appearance, along with the revelation of the Infinity Stone, the Soul Stone, could make Thor Ragnarok the most significant standalone film of Phase 3. I'd love to hear your guys' thoughts on this. Thanks, and keep up the great work.
I would be really surprised if Thanos didn't at least have a small, much like he has in many other MCU films, just a small little quick thing. I'd be surprised if he wasn't there. So I think the chances are pretty good. Schnepp?
Yeah, very high. Like, I'd even say 100% Thanos will be in there. Yeah, it's all about the Infinity Stones and setting up Avengers Infinity War. So that's Thor Ragnarok's the setup for that. So we're going to definitely see Thanos.
What do you think, Mark?
I would be very surprised if Thanos was not in Thor Ragnarok in some capacity. I don't think it's going to be a big role. It might even be a post-credits scene. But that really is the last shot that you have in setting up Thanos for what's going to happen in Infinity War. Now, again, the Infinity War movie is going to be two films, so you do have a split where you can set up a whole Thanos storyline in the first one.
And it's a hell of a drug.
why would it have a budget that much? Stupidity comes to mind.
Oh, are they buying real pirates gold to put in the background?
Building real pirate ships.
I actually got to look this
up.
Well,
so, let's fact check that while Mark and I ramble.
Yeah, you
Mark,
go ahead and
we
ramble.
We know, Jeremy, here's the thing about Beauty and the Beast and why everybody should go see it opening weekend.
That poster's great. Don't you think so?
I think with Pirates 5, well, you do have a lot of star power that you're bringing both into the universe for the very first time. Somebody like Javier Bardem, but you also have Johnny Depp returning. He ain't cheap. You also have Keira Knightley and Orlando Bloom, who are a little more affordable. But I think that must be something with including all the advertising that they're doing for it. Right. There's no way that movie can possibly actually have a production budget of $300 million. There's just no way.
You weave it in when Bardem's like, will you give him a message, please? And tell him, Diet Dr. Pepper tastes more like regular Dr. Pepper.
Yeah, you
brought
make
to
that
you,
money
bud.
Back.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, you can weave in the sponsor.
It can offset some of the costs. Right. Well, the cast that you just mentioned, that's probably almost $100 million. I mean, what's Depp at? This is his fifth film as a.
Yeah, but how big of a role is he going to be in this one?
If you paid Johnny Depp $25 million for this movie,
right.
you're probably paying $25 million for all the other talent combined at the most.
Okay, it's $50,
so $50 million, and then you know, what else? Like, again, are you actually conjuring souls from the dead?
They are
that's,
building
that's
Pirates of
expensive.
The Caribbean, literally yeah. an island. They're building
well,
it.
They're yeah. building a new yeah. Caribbean.
They got to work on Javier Bardem's floating face if it costs that much. Because my God, where are we, John?
Okay, so this is what forgive me. This is just I'm quickly remember we're taking this question live, so I'm just scattering here. The only official thing I've seen, and official comes from the DailyMail.com. Who back in May said there was a $250 million budget and they're $70 million over budget, part of which is because Johnny Depp spent $320,000 of the studio money to fly, to book a private jet to fly his dogs out to Australia. Like, this is not coming from Variety, this is not coming from The Hollywood Reporter. Look, it very well could be that the money, that is gonna be $320 million. I really doubt it, considering how much Disney over the last number of years has been looking. Right. Look, they're no strangers to $200 million films. The last couple of years, they've been looking on tightening up their budgets a little bit. And look, this isn't going to be the movie of the year. I don't even know if that this Caribbean, this will make money. I don't know if it'll break $1 billion this year, because as you've had a track record of making poor movies, I think it might have finally caught up with them. I have a hard time buying the $320 million number. I have a hard time buying it.
That could be all in with P&A. Like, if they're like, hey, we're spending $100 million on print and advertising.
But usually the P&A budgets don't really come till afterwards. This is a report coming in May of 2015. So I doubt they would have had their budgets or their actual numbers for that. But it's possible.
That would make
but they never do. They never
nervous.
Include
it. It's Disney's opening up against another aquatic movie that weekend with Baywatch. And then the next weekend, it's got Wonder Woman to deal with. Like, yes. That's a tough slate.
Yeah, I agree with you. And I think that Disney spent their whole P&A budget on the Beauty and the Beast posters right there.
All right, what's next?
Gabriel Bailey writes, what is the criteria for the Hollywood Reporter Foreign Press as compared to the Academy for what films are eligible for nominations?
John?
I love when okay. Campy goes on this rant.
So here's what the Hollywood Foreign Press does. They take these blindfolds, put it over their eyes, and then darts. And then they throw them against a wall. The Hollywood Foreign Press, look, is a fine. I was actually eligible 1 year for the Hollywood Foreign Press. The Hollywood Foreign Press, as an organization in and of itself, is a perfectly legit and fine organization. Here's the difference between the Hollywood. This is why I give no credit or credence to the Golden Globes, despite the fact that they put on a wonderful show. Mm-hmm. They put on a wonderful show. But their awards mean nothing. Because here's what it is. When you get the Academy, it's 6,000 to 7,000 members of people involved in the industry. Actors, directors, executives, publicists, you know, people who are actually involved in the movie making industry, you know, as well as some other people as well, but 6,000 to 7,000 voting members of people in the industry who know the industry better than anybody else. The Broadcast Film Critics Society has a whole bunch of people who are film journalists. And so I actually give them a little bit of props. The Hollywood Foreign Press, this is it. This is about 60 members, 60 people. And one of the things I say always makes it these ridiculous conspiracy theories about, studio bought off the voting members of the Academy. Mm-hmm. There's 6,000 to 7,000 of them. No, they didn't. Of some people who are richer than those studios to start with. So don't worry about that. Whereas the Hollywood Foreign Press is 60 people. You fly 40 of them out to Vegas, buy them new cars. There you go. You got your wins. But the thing is this. What's the criteria for being a member of the Hollywood Foreign Press? It's simply this. Do you have to have a background in film? No. Do you have to? Nope. Here's what it is. You have to work for a company not based in the U.S., but you yourself live in L.A. That's it. So when I was doing stuff for the movie blog, which is a Canadian-based thing, and living in L.A., I was eligible to be in the Hollywood Foreign Press. It's 60 to 70 people, and that's it. That's the only thing. The Broadcast Film Critics Society has more oomph behind it than that does. So that's why I don't care. What's their criteria? Their criteria is what can we nominate that will get the most attention and get the most celebrities to come to our event? That's their criteria, period.
John, all I heard was I was eligible for someone to buy me a car, and I passed on it. I don't know why you passed on that.
Let's not. Don't let me misrepresent my situation. It's not like the Hollywood Foreign Press sent me an invitation and I turned it down. No. I'm not saying that in the least. No. Okay. I would take that car.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
But nobody's offering cars.
Didn't Denzel make a joke about that?
Yes, he did.
Yeah, he was like, yeah, so and so came to me and said, we're gonna butter him up and you're gonna win. He's like, I won that year.
Because it's 60, it's such a small voting base, 60 to 70 people. I mean, and so that's why I've never given any credence. Although, once again, the Oscars are way more important. But they put on a better show than the Oscars do. They put on a great show every year, and for that, I applaud them. Anyway, anybody else have anything they want to add?
I just think Meryl Streep should get the Cecil B. DeMille Award for the next 4 years. I love it.
Yeah.
All right, what's next?
Drew Yepsen writes, with all the theories coming out about who Snoke is and who Rey is related to, what theory are you most excited to see?
Look, I have been turned on. We've talked about it a little bit. I've been turned on lately by the Ben Kenobi one. I'm starting slowly to buy more and more into the Ben Kenobi theory, that Ben Kenobi is actually Rey's grandfather. Is that the case? I don't know. Who knows? But that's the one that excites me more.
I think here's what I'm taking this question, though, is which theory do I want to see play out more, or which question do I need answered? Which one am I more excited to get the reveal? Is it who Snoke is, or is it what Rey's lineage is? And that is a really, really competitive question for me, because Rey is our hero. She is the hero. Her and Finn are the heroes of the new trilogy, but it's going to focus more on Rey because she is clearly a Force wielder. I want to know who Snoke is, but I think I'd rather know where Rey comes from more.
Yeah, you know what I don't want? I don't actually want a solid answer to Snoke. You remember when in Revenge of the Sith, Palpatine's telling Anakin about Darth Plagueis, right? Mm-hmm. He tells his whole story about Plagueis' apprentice.
Life.
Yeah, right. And he never actually says, oh, Plagueis was my master and I killed him in his sleep. You know, it's up to you to be like, he's telling his story, but you never get that confirmation. I want something like that. I want fragments of a story. I want a story, but I want to have to be like, I'm pretty sure that pertains to that, but I don't actually want someone to be like, this is who Snoke is, and this is why this is important. I don't want that. I want to have to piece it together.
See, I love when Palpy was like, and then someone murdered him in his sleep. No, it was him. Yeah. He's basically saying it. So I think Rey was created by a bunch of those floaty midichlorians by Snoke. That's my guess. I don't think Kenobi's going to be involved at all. I'm probably 100% wrong. But that's what I'd like to see, because that creates a backwards compatibility with the trilogy, mm-hmm. where you basically have, like, Anakin was born out of dust and fibers of these weird floaty whatevers. They're not going to bring in the word midichlorians. I would think that would be stupid. But
no, they're going to avoid that.
They're going to avoid that word. But the idea that someone could be a child of the Force, I think that's what we're going to see.
Yeah, like a vergence. Like, you know, it's like, ooh, there's a vergence in the Force, and it's this kid.
Just
I
like,
can see Rey.
Just like his dad. He could be like, my father was also. That's how you connect Luke with Rey, and he can be the teacher.
Yeah, I can see
that. As far
as
Snoke goes, one theory that's been floating around recently that I still don't buy into, but I'm giving a little bit of credit to, is the Maul theory. And that somebody speculated, you know, with everything that we know about Snoke so far, that would fit with Maul. And that's fine. But what if, you know, if we see in Rebels, because we know it's in the trailer, Maul and Obi-Wan are going to confront each other again. What if Maul doesn't die? What if he just gets beaten badly, disfigured, you know, gets his horns in his head ripped out, all that kind of stuff?
I was going to say, there are horns that we have to account for.
Yeah, which could be part of why he has so much scarring and thing over his head. I'm like, okay, no, I don't think we're going to see, you know, Obi-Wan saying, now I'm going to teach you a lesson, Maul, and yank the horns out of his head. I don't think that's going to happen. But it's an interesting theory.
I'd love to see a horn-yanking episode. What do you think of the last Rebels episode? Oh, it was a horn-yanking good time.
I don't think Maul's going to be involved at all. That's like extra deep Star Wars nerdy sweat, where you're like, what if Maul was involved?
And you look at Snoke's head, just like the shape of his dome. He's got a very smooth, bald head. He's like a Patrick Stewart kind of thing, not like a Maul.
All right, guys, listen, we've run out of time. That'll do it for this installment of the Movie Talk. Thanks so much for joining us. And I want to thank the guys sitting at the table with me. First of all, sitting over there, Mr. Jon Schnepp. Schnepp, where can people find you online?
You can find me later today on Collider Heroes, talking all about Maul and Kenobi and not talking about Star Wars. We can talk about all that nerd, super sweat, Batman and stuff. All right, see you later. You can find me online on Twitter and Instagram. Bye.
Sitting right beside me, Jon Schnepp. Where can people find you?
You can find me at Jon Schnepp, spelled Jeremy Johns, on YouTube, Instagram, and Twitter, and at Real Jeremy Johns on Facebook, and at Verizon Go 90 is my new show, Awesome Tacular, on the Verizon Go 90 network, where we talk all things movie, television, video games. We play some video games. My co-host, Pam Horton. It's a great time. Go check it out.
A fresh returning from Omaha. Mr. Mark Ellis, welcome back, and where can people find you?
Thank you, John. You can find me this weekend at the Comedy Store in Los Angeles. Next week, I'll be at Jeremy Johns' old stomping grounds in Seattle, Washington. I will be sleeping on his red couch, and you guys can find me here, Schmoes No Show.
And over there, of course, we have Ashley Mova.
Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat, Ashley Mova. Happy Tuesday, guys.
And Wendy Lee.
On YouTube at The Movie Couple Channel, and on Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat, at Wendy Lee Zaney.
And you guys can simply follow me on social media, at John Campea. Thanks a lot for joining us, guys, and until next time. Bye-bye.
Hey guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.